Hi, and welcome to the plugin development series part 4. Today we're talking about the GPU, which is very exciting. Previously in our tutorial series, we were looking at drawing a straight line, different methods for that. The first one was a very naive approach. The second one, we used a 2D graphics library to help us, Cairo. And in this lesson, we're going to be using a 3D API called OpenGL to help us. And the reason for that is, although the result may be very similar, just drawing a 2D line, once you've got that, you can very easily expand upon it, add in a Z-axis or your third dimension, depth, and you can draw your line in 3D and look at it through a camera in perspective. And there are other advantages to using the GPU. For example, the GPU is very fast at doing certain things. Usually tasks that can be split up into many smaller problems, the GPU will eat them for breakfast, just because it has many thousands of cores as opposed to a CPU having a few very intelligent cores. Not every problem is faster on the GPU if you just chuck everything on it. Some processing tasks will be faster on the CPU. So you should decide when making a plugin whether you want it to be on the CPU or GPU, which one's going to be faster. Some certain things that GPUs typically do very fast is drawing lots and lots of geometry. Post-processing effects such as bloom or like blurs, glows, those sort of things, they can be faster on the GPU depending on the algorithm. So this tutorial assumes some basic knowledge of OpenGL. If you have at least a beginner knowledge of OpenGL, you should be able to follow along. If you know nothing about OpenGL, you'll probably be very confused, but don't let that stop you. I can't even read, and here I am making a tutorial series on plugin development. To get started, you'll need the After Effects SDK, which you can download for free. And then under Examples, Effect, we have a sample called GLator, very punny. And that uses OpenGL, so no surprises there. This sample has been around a while, since 2007. I believe they just recently added this new one, which also runs on the GPU. This one is much more recent. The issue with it is that it runs on Cuda and Metal. So those are different APIs for communicating with the GPU. There are a number of different APIs you can use to control the GPU, and they all have their pros and cons. For example, there's DirectX, which is Windows only, I believe. Then there's Metal, which is the Mac OS only one. Vulkan is the newest one. That's very popular, but still not much documentation compared to OpenGL, since OpenGL has been around for about 20 years. So that one's harder to get info on, but it seems to be much more performant than OpenGL. There's OpenCL, and then there's Cuda, and I believe Cuda is only available on computers with NVIDIA GPUs. So if you're developing a plugin with Cuda and you want to be able to distribute it to people with AMD cards, you'll then have to add, basically you'll have to double your workload. You'll have to have an if statement. If they have Cuda, do this. If they don't have a card that supports Cuda, then you'll have to rewrite all your processing functions for some other platform such as OpenCL. So it's a lot more work. OpenGL is very cross-platform. As I mentioned, it's really old, so it works on pretty much all older hardware. With that out of the way, I think we'll do a rundown of the GLator sample. I'll just go through it bit by bit and explain it a bit, and then we'll run it, see what it's doing, and then we'll repurpose it for what we want to do with it. So here we are, we'll start at the top, we're just in glator.cpp, and we're using GL binding, which is an extension that helps us communicate with the GPU, and we're using version 3.3 core. There are more recent and there are older versions, but this one seems to work well. You don't have to use GL binding, but if you're using this sample, it's going to use GL binding. Some alternatives include Glue and GLFW. We come up here and go to Smart Render. We have a slider that we're using, and then we have to have a separate OpenGL context because After Effects uses its own OpenGL context, and this is just going to handle that. That's very technical that I wouldn't worry about to begin with. Got some debugging things here, and every frame it's going to run this Initialize Resources function, which is in glbase.cpp. This is very important. Essentially, we have a Boolean value, and if the resolution changes, this is going to be set to true, and then we need to regenerate the resources such as the frame buffer, the render buffer, the textures, and even the VAO, just due to the way that it's set up, but more on that later. So this sample here takes care of the resource allocation for us. It does it in a certain way that you probably wouldn't want if you were to publish a plugin, but it's good for just mucking around and having a play. So it creates its VAO, creates some frame buffers, it creates a texture for us that it also has functions to then upload an After Effects buffer to this texture. It also has two different shaders. Now we'll notice that if in data m program object short unsigned equals zero, then it initializes the shader. So this is only going to happen once. It's going to create, initialize, and compile the shaders on startup, and then it's going to keep reusing them. And we can see those shaders here under GLSL files. So we have the one vertex shader, very simple. We take a position and multiply it by a matrix 4. The first frag shader does a simple texture lookup. This code here is specific to 16 bits per channel only. It doesn't affect 8 and 32. Then it does some swizzling, so it just changes the order of the channels, multiplies the color channels by the alpha channel, and then it sets the green channel to the slider value, which we mentioned in Smart Render, this slider value here. It passes that as a uniform and then sets the green channel to that. And then the second shader here does another texture lookup. And then if we have some alpha, it then divides the color channels by the alpha channel. If we don't have any alpha, it's just going to set it to blank, presumably to avoid unnecessary processing and some divide by zero issues. And then we have another 16 bit per channel only case. So the way that it makes sure this is only happening in 16 bits per channel is this multiply 16 bit is set to a value of 1 if it's 8 or 32 bits per channel. However, if it's 16 bits per channel, it's going to be a different value, say 1.99999, and then that's going to affect the color. As we all know, dividing by something by 1 gives it the same value back. So once we've initialized the resources, it's going to upload the input as a texture. So the input world being your color buffer, the layer that you applied this effect to. If we click in the upload texture, we can see they provided a function to upload the texture for us. This one will generate and bind the texture, set some parameters, then it has a method for sending those to the GPU, and it's different for 32, 16, and 8 bits per channel. As we can see, if we're using 16 bits per channel, the multiplier 16 bit out is a value of approximately 1.999. I have no idea why it has to do this, and I've even posted on the forums regarding this, but I have so far not found an answer as to why the 16 bits per channel has to do this. But it works, so I guess I'll just have to accept it and learn to move on. Once we've uploaded the texture, we have this function, make ready to render, which essentially binds a frame buffer, sets this frame buffer as a texture, then it clears that, and then it does something called RenderGL. So it says it simply blends the texture inside the frame buffer, and you can hack your own shader there. So RenderGL enables some blending. This bit here, when I first started, I found this very confusing. This has to do with the geometry creation. If we go to GL base and under the anonymous namespace, we have a function called create quad. This creates a quad. As you can see, the X and Y coordinates are specified. There is a Z coordinate, but they're not used. They're all initialized to zero. And then these are the UV coordinates. Peculiarly, the X and Y coordinates are set to essentially the width and height of the buffer. So for example, if we're doing a 1920 by 1080 buffer, full HD, the quad itself is going to be massive. It's going to be 1920 units wide. And as you're probably aware, OpenGL does not render geometry that's outside the range of minus 1 to 1. This is a massively huge quad. And then what they do in RenderGL is this matrix here is essentially, it's scaling down that massive quad to fit within the minus 1 to 1 OpenGL world. And that is passed to the vertex shader as this model view projection. The geometry we're dealing with is very basic. It's just a quad. And on that quad, we then stick the input buffer. And so it doesn't look 3D, but it is a 2D plane living in a potentially 3D world. So then we bind the input texture that we've already generated. We use the program that was generated in the initializing the resources. So, and we send those uniforms matrix. We send the slider value, which will affect the green channel. And then we send the multiply 16 bit, which helps the 16 bits per channel to look correct. And then it has its own another function here, which sets the active texture. then it binds the VAO, it renders the quad, we've got this other function here, and then it unbinds those. So we can see there's a lot of code here. That's why object-oriented programming is so popular with people doing OpenGL, because it helps to minimize the amount of code that you need to keep reusing. There's a lot of reused code. So now that the render GL has completed, we're now going to use the result of that render as the texture for another render. So then we've got another OpenGL make ready to render, report if there's an error, you can click in that to see what's going on, clear it, and then we have Swizzle GL, which essentially, as mentioned, it's going to take the render of render GL, and then it's going to apply some more pixel processing, which is what we might refer to as post-processing. And that is using the second fragment shader, fragment shader underscore two, that will take the buffer that we rendered and then divide the color channels by the alpha channel. And once that's done, it's got some more debugging things here. I believe GRemedy is deprecated. I couldn't find much info on that. And then it's going to download the texture. So similarly to upload texture, which we have here, we have a special function for downloading textures from the GPU to any buffer, any After Effects buffer that you set. In this case, the output buffer. This allocates some memory and then copies it from the GPU to that memory. Then it cleans it up and then it does a little bit of cleanup. And this is more just After Effects specific stuff. So now that we've done a brief overview of the project, let's build it and see the result. So come up to build solution. I'm going to create a solid and then add some fractal noise just so we've got a pattern on the screen. And then the plugin is called GLator. And we can see if we go to the green channel here is set to whatever value the slider is. So we're 50% gray. We can make it black or we can make it white, and the other channels, we can see that it's pixel perfect. We've taken the fractal noise buffer, projected it onto a 2D quad, and it's done in such a way that it's indistinguishable from when we've turned the plugin on or off if we're just looking at the red channel. If we're looking at the green channel, that's been changed, and also we have the alpha channel working, so we could apply a mask, and yes, we've got the alpha channel. So not particularly impressive, however, this template is a very powerful starting place for us to be able to do pretty much anything. In our next video, we will tear it apart and repurpose it for our nefarious purposes of drawing a straight line. And in the later lesson, we'll start doing some really fun stuff with shaders and post-processing. So thank you for watching. Apologies if this lesson has been a bit dry, but it is really exciting what you can do on the GPU. Our plugin Deep Glow is built using the GPU, and we are definitely planning to make more GPU-based plugins in the future just because of how powerful they can be. So if you're interested in that, check out Plugin Everything, check out Deep Glow, and make sure you subscribe for more future videos on After Effects plugin development and just everything about plugins.